Good morning and welcome to the National Shrine of St. Elizabeth Ann Seton. My name is Sister Joan Draga, and I am a daughter of charity living and working here in Emmitsburg, Maryland, the home and final resting place of St. Elizabeth Ann Seton. I am honored to welcome all of you to this celebration of our beloved saint. 200 years ago, on January 4th, 1821, Mother Seton was welcomed into the glory of heaven. And since then, thanks to thousands of sisters and lay ministers, her message of faith and hope has reached around the world. Especially during these difficult times, that message resonates strongly and continues to touch countless lives. Truly, she is a saint for our times. On behalf of the Sisters and Daughters of Charity, we welcome you, Archbishop Laurie, all of you present here today, and those joining us through EWTN and our live streams. May today's liturgy unite us in the same faith that St. Elizabeth Ann Seton professed. And may we always remain united until we join her in the glory of heaven. Come, let us worship.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Peace be with you. Welcome so warmly by Sister Joan, and in the joy of this very special celebration of the feast of St. Elizabeth Ann Seton, let us ask for the grace to place ourselves in God's presence so as to celebrate these sacred mysteries worthily and well. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Thank you.
us pray. O God, who crowned with the gift of true faith St. Elizabeth Ann Seton's burning zeal to find you, grant by her intercession and example that we may always seek you with diligent love and find you in daily service with sincere faith. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Proverbs. When one finds a worthy wife, her value is far beyond pearls. Her husband, entrusting his heart to her, has an unfailing prize. She brings him good and not evil all the days of her life. She obtains wool and flax and cloth with skillful hands. She puts her hands to the distaff, and her fingers ply the spindle. She reaches out her hands to the poor and extends her arms to the needy. Charm is deceptive and beauty fleeting. The woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her a reward of her labors, and let her works praise her at the city gates. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, yeah. A reading from the letter of St. John. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is of God. Everyone who loves is begotten by God and knows God. Whoever is without love does not know God, for God is love. In this way, the love of God was revealed to us. God sent his only begotten Son into the world so that we might have life through him. In this love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as expiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we must also love one another. No one has ever seen God, yet if we love one another, God remains in us, and his love is brought to perfection in us. This is how we know that we remain in him and he in us, that he has given us of his Spirit. Moreover, we have seen and testified that the Father sent his Son as Savior of the world. Whoever acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God remains in him and he in God. We have come to know and to believe in the love God has for us. God is love, and whoever remains in love remains in God, and God in him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the Pharisees heard that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a scholar of the law, tested him by asking, "Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest?" He said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment. The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. The whole law and the prophets depend on these two commandments. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Brother bishops and priests, your religious sisters, and all dear friends in the Lord Jesus Christ. 200 years ago today, Elizabeth Ann Bailey Seton entered into eternal life. We have gathered on this, her feast day, not merely to recall the events of her extraordinary life, but indeed to give thanks for her enduring influence among women and men of every vocation and every state of life in the church. For the authentic holiness of her life, coupled with her heavenly intercession, mean that she is much more than a figure of history, someone confined to the pages of history. Rather, she is a living friend in the courts of heaven and a lamp actively guiding our steps on earth. To illustrate her influence, let me begin with two archbishops of Baltimore whom St. Elizabeth Ann Seton has profoundly influenced. The year was 1835. And a very bright young man from a prominent Episcopalian family in New York City had just graduated from Washington College, later Trinity College, in Hartford, Connecticut. The young man's name was James Roosevelt Bailey, eventually the first Bishop of Newark and the eighth Archbishop of Baltimore. His father, Dr. Guy Bailey, envisioned for his son a bright future as a medical doctor, but James and his friend John Williams felt a call to become ministers in the Episcopal Church. They were placed under the tutelage of a Dr. Samuel Jarvis in Middleton, Connecticut, in whose extensive library James familiarized himself with ancient Christian writers. James's exposure to those writers would later influence his decision to become a Catholic and to study for the priesthood. But that exposure was not decisive. More decisive was the influence of his deceased aunt, Elizabeth Ann Bailey Seton. In a letter to Mother Seton's daughter, Catherine, aka Cousin Kate, James attributed his conversion to the prayers, and I quote, of your sainted mother. And a few lines later, referred to her again as a saint in heaven. James, in his turn, influenced his brother William to become Catholic, and both of them had a warm and loving devotion to their aunt. Years later, in his funeral oration for Archbishop Bailey, Bishop John Foley of Chicago spoke of his aunt's influence on Archbishop Bailey. He said, "She was like himself, a convert. and the Archbishop, in conversation with friends, ascribed his conversion to the prayers of this great, good, and venerated woman. Another Archbishop of Baltimore, whom St. Elizabeth Ann Seton influences greatly, is the incumbent. I was blessed to study for the priesthood at Mount St. Mary's Seminary. And like many a seminarian, I often came from the mountain to the valley, here to pray at the tomb of St. Elizabeth Ann Seton. Recalling her incisive criticisms of the careless preaching of a certain priest by the name of Father Hickey, I asked her to pray for me, that I would learn how to preach reasonably well. And to tell you the truth, for some reason this morning, I'm feeling rather nervous. I also remember thanking her for the Catholic schools I attended, and I asked her help as I tried to teach high school here in Emmitsburg at St. Joseph's under the tutelage of the then principal, Sister Ethelrita. In 1974, my second year of theology, Pope Paul VI canonized Mother Seton, and I remember benefiting so much from the talks and homilies and articles occasioned by that great event. But more than any of that, I felt then, and I feel now, that I meet St. Elizabeth Ann Seton in you, the daughters and sisters of charity, you who are her spiritual heirs, you who carry forward her charism and her mission of charity, whose foundations we see so clearly in the scripture readings proclaimed this morning. In the surprising events and distressing tribulations of her life, Elizabeth always sensed, and I quote, the protective presence and the consoling grace of her Redeemer. She wrote, "He raises me from the dust, drives away all sorrows. He is my guide, my friend, and my supporter. With such a guide, what can I fear?" St. John, the beloved disciple, put that same truth another way. He wrote, "And this is love, not that we have loved God, but that God has loved us and has sent his Son as an expiation for our sins." Responsive to God's loving and guiding hand in the events of her life, Elizabeth reflected her love of God in a life of overflowing charity for others. Overflowing charity for her family, her husband and children, and her friends. Overflowing charity for the students that she educated in that little house on Packer Street in Baltimore. The abundant charity she shared with her sisters in her foundation here at Emmitsburg. Love that flowed from this place throughout North America and eventually to every part of the world. At bottom, her influence on us today is so great because every day and in every circumstance, she lived to the uttermost the words of Jesus. "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself." This is why 200 years after her death, Mother Seton's influence is still so strongly felt. Her influence is felt by mothers and fathers who amid the challenges of these days strive to form their children in the faith by providing a home that is secure and holy. What grieving spouse cannot find consolation in the spiritual strength of Elizabeth as she bade farewell to her beloved husband in Italy when he died of tuberculosis? Even as society turns a cold shoulder to religious faith, there are nonetheless many, many souls right in our midst who are searching for truth, just as Elizabeth Ann and her nephew James sought and found the fullness of faith. Especially in these days of the pandemic, our heroic Catholic school principals and teachers can look to St. Elizabeth Ann Seton for strength, recalling her tremendous sacrifices to educate the young and her role in the founding of the Catholic school system in these United States. Our educators can see in this great saint a role model and an intercessor in challenging times. And those who are searching for their vocation, maybe a call to consecrated life or to priesthood, they can find in this great saint a role model for answering God's call and consecrating oneself to the Lord and to the mission he has in mind for us. And let us not forget that many, many people who have never heard of this great saint, but who meet St. Elizabeth Ann Seton in the ministries sponsored by the Sisters of Charity Federation. They meet her in the compassionate care offered in healthcare ministries that are sponsored by your congregations. They meet her in the Catholic schools that you continue to sponsor, staff, and sustain. They meet her in your consecrated lives, in which you have laid aside all else to bear witness to the one who is single-hearted in love, poor in spirit, and obedient to God's saving will. These people may not know St. Elizabeth Ann Seton or the amazing events of her life, but through you, they experience her overflowing love for God and for neighbor. Marking the 200th anniversary of St. Elizabeth Ann Seton's birth into eternal life, let us give thanks, perhaps as never before, for her amazing witness to the Lord's love. Our first native-born American saint is indeed a saint for everyone, for those who are married, those who are bereaved, those in consecrated life, for bishops and priests and deacons striving for holiness, for those seeking the fullness of faith, for Catholic educators and healthcare professionals, and especially for those who are served by ministries of education and healthcare that she inspired. It seems to me that St. Elizabeth Ann Seton is a patron to whom we can all relate. And if you want my opinion, next to the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. Elizabeth Ann Seton is an ideal patron for the Church in the United States. I am sure that Archbishop James Roosevelt Bailey would concur with me, as would Catholics from every walk of life in these United States and far beyond. There is still a lot of work to do to bring this about, but I do hope and pray that this most influential saint may one day be declared, after the Blessed Virgin Mary, the patron of these United States. Saint Elizabeth Ann Bailey Seton, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Together now, let us profess our holy Catholic faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Saint Elizabeth Ann Seton and all the saints constantly intercede for us. May they echo our prayers as we present them to God, our Heavenly Father.
For our Holy Father, Pope Francis, our bishops, and for all those who provide leadership within the Church, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For men and women graced with a vocation to the priesthood or consecrated life, particularly to the Sisters and Daughters of Charity. May they respond to their call as St. Elizabeth Ann Seton did, with courage and joy. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For families, especially single-parent families, and those facing illness or financial hardship, may they know the loving providence of God. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For students, teachers, and school administrators, as they return to school after the Christmas break, may they actively pursue truth and charity as Mother Seton did. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an end to the pandemic and for all those essential personnel who have sacrificed to care for others throughout this difficult time. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions of shrine visitors, benefactors, and those who call the shrine's prayer line ministry. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the faithful departed, may they share the joy of heaven with Saint Elizabeth Ann Seton and all the saints. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, look with favor on the request of your servants who treasure the kingdom of heaven above all things. Grant them renewed enthusiasm for their vocations, especially those who, like St. Elizabeth Ann Seton, embrace the life of poverty, chastity, and obedience. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. O Lord, we ask that you look graciously upon our gifts placed upon your altar in celebration of Saint Elizabeth Ann Seton, and grant that by the power at work in this sacrifice, that we may be more deeply inserted into the mystery of your Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God. For in the saints who consecrated themselves to Christ for the sake of the kingdom of heaven, it is right to celebrate the wonders of your providence, by which you call human nature back to its original holiness and bring it to experience on this earth the gifts you promise in the new world to come. And so with all the angels and saints, we praise you, as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, giving you thanks. He said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." the mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, in recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who were nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Elizabeth Ann Seton and all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope, William our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you, the passing from this life, can admit us to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. Through Christ, our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, O Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen.
Take away the sins of the world.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Thank you. Let us pray. As we partake of the sacrament of our salvation, while recalling the memory of St. Elizabeth Ann Seton, we humbly ask you, O Lord, that we may be inflamed by a burning desire for the heavenly table, and by its power consecrate our life faithfully to you. Through Christ our Lord.
Good afternoon. My name is Rob Judge. It is my privilege to serve as the executive director here at the Seton Shrine. On behalf of the Sisters and Daughters of Charity who oversee the Seton Shrine, I want to wish all of you a happy and blessed feast day, and thank you for joining us in prayer for today's liturgy. All of us at the Seton Shrine invite each of you to take this anniversary year as an opportunity to become more familiar with Mother Seton. For those watching on EWTN, please stay tuned immediately after the Mass for the broadcast premiere of the Seton Shrine's new short film entitled Elizabeth Ann Seton, Seeker to Saint. The film presents the inspiring story of Mother Seton's life, which left an extraordinary imprint on the Catholic Church and our nation. You can view the film and also learn more about other anniversary year initiatives at our website, setonshrine.org. In closing, I want to convey our gratitude to all who made this beautiful liturgy possible, including our many liturgical ministers, the Knights of Columbus, our deacon and the Archbishop's delegate to our area, Deacon Christopher Young, all of our concelebrating priests, and our concelebrating bishops, Bishop Bruce Landowski, Auxiliary Bishop of Baltimore, and Bishop Roy Campbell, Auxiliary Bishop of Washington, D.C. And of course, we extend our deep gratitude to you, Archbishop Lurie, for enthusiastically supporting the work of the Seton Shrine, particularly in this 200th anniversary, and for leading us in worship today. We are grateful. Thank you.
And now, my dear friends, as we bring our Holy Mass to its conclusion, we ask the intercession of St. Elizabeth Ann Seton upon us all, upon our vocations, upon our family and loved ones, upon our mission and ministry, and upon all of our works of heart and hand. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Our help is in the name of the Lord. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.